You also wrote books as Richard Bachman, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. I keep all my books sort of hidden away in a corner. By Rudolph. This is Rudolph. He minds the place when I'm not around. Get back, Rudolph. Let's see, Bachman. Where are we here? Here's Thinner, here, which was the last of the Bachman books. And I'd done four other books that were not very much like what I usually do. That is to say, they were four novels that weren't horror novels. And this one sort of was. And we tried everything that we could think of to keep the secret, including this jacket photo here. I don't know if you can see that.
It's a fake photograph. Richard Bachman.
If you put this Richard Bachman up against me, you'll see that
there's not much similarity.
There's not much similarity. This Richard Bachman is a tire salesman from Minneapolis, Minnesota. He's a friend of my agent's, and we asked him if he would mind having his picture on a book, because if people actually saw the picture, maybe they would think that it really wasn't me. But there was a guy who worked for a bookstore in Washington, D.C., who read my books, who'd also read the Bachman books. And he wrote me a letter and said, I've looked in the Library of Congress, and I noticed that the copyrights for the Bachman books are held in the name Stephen King. Do you have anything to say about this?
That was it. The end.
The game was over, and so I simply owned up to it. But for a while there, Bachman was good. Bachman and I have collaborated on a novel now. He's a much nastier writer than I am.
But why did you want to write as Bachman? Because you wrote too much. I mean, you were
afraid of
saturating the market.
I was afraid of saturating the market. I was told that that could happen. And so Bachman was a place to get rid of those books. And, you know, the other thing was I was curious.
But how many copies did you sell as Bachman?
As Bachman, probably on Thinner, this one here, probably about 25,000 copies as Bachman. And then when it came out that Bachman was really Stephen King, it sold another 400,000. Sometimes I feel like a little factory. It's an unpleasant feeling, because what I do, if it's an industry, then it's a cottage industry. It's something that, how can I say, every article in this shop is handmade. Whatever the equipment, whether it's the word processor, or whether it's the pen that I keep in my pocket, or whether it's the typewriter, these are handmade products. Somebody asked me once, how do you write? And my answer was, one word at a time. And he thought I was being facetious or making a joke, but that's the way that it is. But once it gets outside and it gets into the world, you see these signs that say, Stephen King, 40 million copies sold, 60 million copies sold. It's like the slogan of a business or something like that. The movies are made. They standardize the type so that your name looks the same from one book to another. And it does seem a little bit like a factory business.
I can imagine you have a lot of fan mail.
It grows around you. You know, what's happened to me is a little bit like a little piece of grit that forms a pearl, except what's formed around me, first one secretary, then two secretaries, then a business manager in New York to handle the money end of things. There's a caretaker to keep people off the grass, to holler people away. There's legal help. But nobody's life stays entirely simple. If you're a success, you try to cope with these things. And what I try to do is to keep myself from being eaten alive by either fans on one side or by the people. The money generates this kind of sort of structure. And I try to keep away from that as much as I can.
Jethro Tull, part of the machine. Haynes Rock Zone, WZON. It's currently sunny and 86 at WZON Bangor. This is Doug Shannon.
The T-Birds on the Z. Powerful stuff. Yeah. Well, this poor thing's seen better days, hasn't it?
You own a radio station as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Why did you buy it?
Oh, I bought it because it was for sale and because it looked as though it was going to go to a kind of middle-of-the-road satellite transmission kind of thing, elevator music for yuppies sort of thing. And I like kick-ass rock and roll. Mm. So I bought the station, and it's an AM rocker, and we've stayed on the air with the help of maniacs like Doug here.
Hmm. Why do you love rock and roll so much?
I don't know. You might as well ask me why I love steak, you know, or why I love green beans. Hmm.
You grew up with it.
I grew up with it, and I can remember from my seventh birthday getting an Elvis Presley 78. It's a Hound Dog backed by Don't Be Cruel, and I played the spots off that record. Hmm. Just couldn't get enough of it, and I've been rocking ever since.
Hmm. Don't you think that there are better investments than buying a radio station?
There's a thousand better investments than buying a radio station, but the object is not to make an investment that will pay off big bucks. The object is to have some fun, you know, and to keep something that seems to me, anyway, worth keeping, you know, which is real rock and roll. Rock and roll is a big part of my life and always has been.
But you have your own newsletter, the Stephen King newsletter.
Castle Rock here? Yeah, this is the rock, and it's a family affair. And what happened was the fans just got so out of control, there was so much fan mail that this seemed like a good way to take it off, take some of the pressure off me. So they do articles about the movies that are coming out and the books. It's basically a fan newsletter.
While sitting here near the swimming pool, one could say you look like a Roman emperor.
Well, all I can say is the resemblance between me and a Roman emperor is purely coincidental. It isn't anything other than the setting. And I suppose that if you have money, if money comes to you as a result of what you do, you will spend it. You'll find something to spend it on. We don't own any yachts or any Rolls Royces. We don't have a private plane or any of that stuff. I prefer
You could buy it.
I could buy it, yeah. Yes, I could, but I don't really have any urge to. I wear mostly jeans and sneakers and things like that because they're comfortable. And because it doesn't much matter. As it so happens, the pool was actually my wife's idea, and she uses it a good deal more than I do, but I'm delighted that she has it and the kids have it.
Maybe an indiscreet question, but is it true that you earn $1 million a month?
I don't know if I could say. I don't think so, no. That's too much. It's a lot of money that I make. How much it might be, I couldn't say for sure. And if you ask me how much I'm worth, I would say probably over $20 million. But to me, that means nothing. I have $70 or $80 in my pocket, and if I need to go out and buy a package of cigarettes, I can. Or if I need to buy a new pair of jeans, I can do that. If I need to fill the gas tank, I can do that. Beyond that, my ambitions aren't very high. I'm not a jet-set kind of a guy, you know. I don't have to spend money or feel that I have to spend money on quantities of drugs, alcohol, parties, any of that stuff. I'm actually a kind of boring man.
I can imagine that you start to drink because of your success, no?
Mm-hmm. I drank heavily for years and finally decided that something had to be done about that. There are traps for anybody who has enough money. You can drink yourself to death. You can drug yourself to death. You can party yourself to death. You can work yourself to death. Those options are all open to you. And I decided that I didn't want that kind of life. And if it was going to be the kind of life where the bottle was controlling me, that it would be wisest to put it away altogether, which I've done. You have to develop a sense of priorities in your life. You have to decide what comes first in your life. And with me, I've tried to keep these things in order, my family, my work, myself, and to try to keep a little distance from the world that's out there that's sort of glittery, and it's a world where people live on celebrity or fame. I came to a decision some years ago in New York. I was walking down the street one day, and this was back when I was still drinking a lot, and I had a hangover. And I saw a woman start to walk toward me, and you pick this up after a while. She looked at me, she looked away, and then her eyes snapped back, and I could see her registering who I was. She'd recognize me. And I knew that she was going to walk up to me and say, "Are you Stephen King?" And I thought to myself, "No, I'll say that I'm not." And then I thought to myself, the day that I deny my identity, the day that I say that I'm not who I am, is the day that I quit this business forever and close up shop, turn off the word processor, and never write another word. Because if the price that you're going to pay for what you do is a loss of your identity, it's time to stop.
Hey, she always keeps me satisfied. That's Philly Satellite and Doug Shannon. And Stephen King has dropped by to harass me this morning.
It's your spider, Doug.
Yes, that's my
you should
spider.
See this. I mean, if the people out there could see this, they'd turn off their radios and run screaming. It's a great big tarantula. You scratch it on the mic. Can you hear that?
Oh, yeah.
That's the sound of the killer tarantula, ladies and gentlemen. Hey. One more summer, one more star, one more beat from this old heart to make her mine. Give me one more summer, one more summer, one more star, one more beat from this old heart to make her mine. Stephen King, master of macabre. A rattlesnake that somebody sent me. Just sort of came in the mail. And vampire bats come in the mail. And in fact, I have two vampire bats. This guy looks like he's trying to break out. I don't know if you can see it, but the top has gotten decidedly sweaty. So it's the sort of thing where I've never objected. People are going to call you what they're going to call you. And I don't see any sense in arguing with that. I just write my stories.
Are you influenced by classical horror authors?
We all are, to some degree. For me, the trick was to find some kind of bridge between the sort of gothic horror stories that were written in the 18th century and the world that I live in today, the modern world. Frankenstein was never a book that really excited me very much. Dracula was, but they're both set in Europe, and there's a feeling of antiquity about them. There are castles, moors, and I don't live in that world. I live in a world, small towns, modern American people, automobiles, drive-ins, McDonald's, Burger King, bowling alleys.
Burger King?
Burger King. No relation to me. It might be possible to bring, for instance, a vampire to America. And I wrote a novel called Salem's Lot, where a European vampire comes to a small main town.
Jerusalem's Lot.
Jerusalem's Lot, and settles in and opens an antique store and turns this whole town of boarding house owners and barbers, small town policemen, into vampires. And it worked like a bomb. I learned from what I read, and I imitated what I liked. And little by little, I found my own voice. When I read H.P. Lovecraft, everything that I wrote came out sounding like H.P. Lovecraft. When I read Ray Bradbury, everything came out and sounded like Ray Bradbury. Nothing that I wrote sounded like Stephen King, but that was okay, because as a kid of 14 or 15 or 16, you don't exist. You're not there yet. You haven't arrived. You're still busy making yourself. And the other thing that happened with me is that people would say you ought to write about what you know. But what I knew was boring. I grew up in a small town. We had no running water. I went to a one-room school with all the grades together, and somebody had to go up to a house and bring back water. And to me, the whole existence was not pastoral or beautiful or anything. It was just boring. I wanted to be in outer space. I wanted to fight monsters in the swamps of the Amazon. So those were the things that I wrote about. And later, I found a way to blend those two interests, my interest in what was strange and alien, and the places where I lived and where I grew up and the people that I knew. Jesus, I can't believe that.
This reminds you very much of your childhood, this neighborhood?
Yes, it does. It does. Same dirt road, same old Grange Hall at the end of the road. Everybody's got a dog tied up behind their house, barks all night long.
That's you.
That's me when I sold my first story. I look a little bit surprised about the whole thing. Yeah, that's me. This is my mother and my brother, who is 2 years older, who is 2 years older. He lives in New Hampshire now, and runs an appliance shop. My mother's dead. She died of cancer in 1973, and that's me. Our father deserted us when I was two. According to my mother, he told her one night he was going to go out for a package of cigarettes and just never came back. From the way she describes him, I've had such good fortune in my own life, I almost think he would have shown up with his hand out for some money. But he never has, and my guess is he's probably dead. He was kind of a rake and a bounder. He wrote himself, submitted stories to a lot of the pulp magazines of the 40s and early 50s, Argosy, Weird Tales, the Saturday Evening Post, things like that, and had some encouraging letters back, but my mother said he never had the ambition to stick to it and break through.
So, but one can say that the imagination comes probably from him.
I would guess so. You know, we found boxes of his things in
books and
his books and papers, and he was a navigator in the Merchant Marine, and we found boxes of his books and papers in my aunt's attic, and I'd started to publish Weird Tales by then, and I found a whole box of paperbacks about monsters and demons and boogeymen. So apparently he had some of the same interests.
But what does it mean if you have to grow up without a father?
It means that you're a little more insecure, I think, than you would be otherwise. You only have the one parent. And I used to wonder what would happen to me if my mother should die when I was a kid. I'd be an orphan, and I wasn't sure exactly what that would mean, to be an orphan.
You didn't change too much in all those years.
Well, I think that I learned how to open my eyes on camera. I'm not sure. That was taken when I was 11, and the school photographer would come in with a huge old camera with a great big flash attachment on top with a hood so that he could focus it right at your eyes. And everybody learned to look at the camera, and he'd say, "Now open your eyes wide," and you'd open your eyes wide, and he would go for the trigger, and then you'd go, "Mm," like that. So everybody turned into a little Chinaman.
But was there already at that time the fascination for...
Yes, for the macabre.
Yeah?
Yeah, as a child it was always there. I loved the horror comics. I saved up my allowance to go see the horror movies like The Black Scorpion or The Creature from the Black Lagoon. Anything that had monsters in it, it scared me, but it excited me at the same time.
You also went to the movies, to horror movies?
All I could. They used to have Saturday matinees. And on Saturday afternoon, we'd all line up, usually with our money tied in a handkerchief or something so we wouldn't lose it. And I wrote about some of this stuff in a book called It. It's funny. I think a lot of us have only the haziest memories of our childhood because we don't try very hard to remember. We can access some of the good memories. And maybe we can access some of the really bad memories if a bully beat us up on the schoolyard or something like that. But what I discovered in writing it was that the more I thought about my childhood from 1953 to, say, 1959, the more those memories came back, standing in line with a quarter, how mean the lady was at the little glass booth, the ticket booth. She wanted to see your money. She'd wear this bright, bright lipstick, and she had mean wrinkles all down her face, and we used to call her Godzilla, you know. And then we'd get in the theater, and everybody would turn their popcorn boxes into bugles, and there'd be the cartoon and the news of the world. And then the giant grasshoppers would come on and destroy Chicago or London, and that was great. It was a great way. I can remember going to the movies, walking down. It was a walk of maybe 2 miles, and I'd see kids in their front yard, and I'd feel so bad for them because they weren't going to the movies. Because for me, they were very important. And then I'd go home afterwards and write stories that were based on the movies that I'd seen. For goodness sake, I got the hippie, hippie
shake. Yeah, I got the shake. I got the hippie, hippie shake.
Usually around 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock in the morning, I'll come up here, crank up some rock and roll on the stereo, and write until about noon. And a lot of times at night, after everybody's gone to bed or everybody's someplace else, I'll come up again and work on something else that's just kind of fun. So,
how many pages do you write a day? A lot.
Well, I'm working on the rewrite of something now, a book called The Stand, where I'm putting copy back in. So I try to stick to about 8 pages a day. Sometimes it goes a little faster than other times. And in the summertime, it gets hot up here. This used to be the barn. So it gets very warm, and I like to get out of here in a hurry if I can.
But eight pages a day, it means that you can have a few books a year.
I could, if they were all good, but on the other hand, I've got something here that I spent most of the fall working on, and the winter. This is called On the Island. It's a piece of shit. I'm sorry, but it is. Before we're born, it's like God throws meteorites at our brains, and they land in there, and they're embedded, and they're full of some kind of alloy, and sooner or later, you feel a magnetism, you feel a pull in a certain direction. And for me, it's always been stories of make-believe. And I like to scare people. You know, my idea about what you're supposed to do with a reader is sort of say, "I got something to tell you. Come on, come on, it's right around here. Come on, come on."